The oil gushing from that ruptured well in the Gulf may have been flowing at twice the rate previously thought. With President Obama preparing to visit the Gulf region once again on Monday and Tuesday, officials are still trying to get a handle on just what they're up against. And joining us now, the U.S. government's point man on the scene in this disaster in the Gulf, Thad Allen, the admiral from the U.S. Coast Guard. Admiral, how could the government have gotten these flow rates so wrong? Originally, BP said 1,000 barrels a day, then it was 5,000 barrels a day, then more recently it was 12 to 19,000 barrels a day. Now they're saying it's actually double that, 20 to 40,000 barrels a day, and then that was before this cut and cap procedure was put into place. What's going on here?
Well, Wolf, thanks for asking the question, because I think we need to have a good discussion about this. First of all, these are the government estimates, and these are being developed by our flow rate technical team under the direction of Marsha McNutt, the head of the US Geological Survey, and have some of the best scientists around the country that are involved in this. I have told them from the start when I set this group up, we need to continue to challenge our assumptions, refine our work, and to the extent we can improve on our estimating, we need to do that. And they have been doing that, and I told them to come back periodically and let's see if we can get this to a much better place as far as accuracy. The fact of the matter is we're never going to know to a virtual certainty what that flow is until we can actually measure it through a pipe with no oil leakage. But in the meantime, we need to continually refine these estimates, and they are government estimates, and they will continue to change, and hopefully they'll continue to get more accurate.
And presumably it could be a whole lot worse after the cut procedure in early June took place, because it was going to open it up. But we don't know how much, by a factor of 20% or by multiple factors. Do you right now, Admiral, have any idea how much oil is still spewing out?
Well, Wolf, what we've done is we went back and we developed the new estimate, as you've discussed. And the next thing we want to do is add on what we think the incremental difference is as a result of the cut in the riser pipe. And we're doing that a couple of different ways. The same team is now impaneled to take the increment that might have changed with the riser cut. And we're also going to use an ROV to deploy some pressure sensors down on the blowout preventer to actually get some empirical readings of the pressure down there. Dr. Stephen Chu and Secretary Salazar are working with BP on that. So this rebaselining of the estimate is a first step in refining our estimates moving forward post riser cut, and also to get some better readings with pressure. We've had some problems with so many ROVs operating down there, but we're going to put some actual sensors down there and get some pressure readings over the next couple of days. I would expect this estimate could evolve over the next 4 or 5 days as we know more about what's going on in the with the pressure readings that we're going to be taking.
So if BP is capturing about 15,000 barrels a day right now over a 24-hour period, we don't know if 10,000 barrels are still spewing in, or 30,000 or 40,000. The answer is we really don't know how much oil is still going into the Gulf as we speak right now.
Wolf, we're not going to know until we can actually seal the pipe, produce the oil that's coming out there, and actually get an empirically measured production based on the pressures. We will be able to do that as we move the new oil containment system in that's going to be replacing the one we have right now over the next 2 to 3 weeks. So we hope to be able to actually cap the well and produce what we can bring up through the diameter of the well bore. At that point, we'll have an accurate measurement.
When are we going to see more of the high-resolution video that the scientists, the outside experts you've brought into this flow rate technical group, when are we going to see it? So far, we've seen about 30 seconds of that high-resolution video, and that was done before the early June cap procedure took place.
Well, we have both pre-cut and post-cut video that we're going to be using, Wolf. One of the problems is the video you see streaming that we're all used to seeing right now actually gets relayed by satellite, and the density of those pictures is not as good as a high-resolution video. We actually have to physically take discs from the ships that are over the top of their ROVs and bring that back. And the other thing is, not all the video is usable for what we want. We need to have the right light, the right sequence of events to be able to assess the percentage of oil, natural gas, and water that's in that stream at any particular time. So while all of it is interesting, only parts of it are really useful to the scientists for getting the best measurements they can.
Well, how difficult is it to take a disc from the ship out there and bring it to shore and let us see it, let the American people see what you're seeing?
Oh, it's not difficult at all. The real issue is going through the hours and hours of video, the high-resolution video, and finding the ones that has the attributes that will give us the best measurement or the best means of estimation. What we're trying to find is basically those areas that best represent the flow, and the flow fluctuates. There are areas where there'd be maybe more gas than oil or more oil than gas. What we're trying to figure out is, can we come up with the right profile of the percentages of those elements that make up that flow, Wolf?
I want you to listen to what Billy Nungesser, he's the president of the Plaquemines Parish, said before Congress this week. Listen to this.
I still don't know who's in charge. Is it BP? Is it the Coast Guard? When I get mad enough in a meeting, the Coast Guard in our office stands up and says, I can make that happen. When I throw a BP official out of my office, he comes back the next day and approves something. I have spent more time fighting the officials of BP and the Coast Guard than fighting the oil.
He's clearly frustrated. What do you want to say to Billy Nungesser?
Well, I've talked with the parish president on several occasions. I met with him with the president specifically to address the issues of the parish presidents. We have sub-aggregated our response in this bill to tailor it to specifically to the request of the parish presidents. And they all have a different set of issues that they're dealing with. They all have a different set of priorities. To make sure we do that correctly and are responsive, we placed a Coast Guard officer with each parish president. And that has been working fine for the last couple of weeks. I would just ask Mr. Nungesser if he's got a problem with our particular officer. I'd be glad to sit down and take the list of complaints that he has and act on them. But those officers have been there supporting him at my direction for several weeks now.
So who is in charge? Is it the Coast Guard? Is it you? Or is it BP?
The federal on-scene coordinator, by law, is the coordinating official for this and has the final authority on the spill response.
So when you make a decision and you tell BP to do it, they have no choice, they have to do it, is that right?
If we issue an administrative order to BP and they fail to comply, there are civil and criminal penalties associated with that. Most of the things we do to BP are informal direction that's provided to them. If it has to get to the point where we issue a written order, we can do that. And again, there are civil and criminal penalties for failure to adhere to it.
I know you've told BP to open up the areas and be transparent, not hide anything from the American public. But our reporters who are on the scene still are having difficulty. BP saying, employees of BP on the coast saying, you know what, we were instructed, we can't speak to the press. Listen quickly to Tom Foreman, one of our reporters, who had this experience this week.
When we first showed up, security forces said, no, you cannot take their pictures, that's forbidden. And we said, why not? It's a free beach, it's a free country. After a while, they relented on that, but then they said, you cannot talk to the workers on the beach. We said, BP specifically issued a statement that workers were free to talk, and the security guards guarding these workers said, we have been told to not let the media speak to anybody who's working on this beach, nor let the workers talk to them.
What about that? What about all these restrictions that BP has placed on their employees and effectively barred reporters and camera crews who are representing the people of the United States because we want to see what's going on? What about that concern?
Well, Wolf, I made it very, very clear that unless there's a safety or security issue, and there, we do have valid safety and security issues in some places, other than that, there should be free, unfettered access by the media to wherever they want to go. If I can get the exact information on those people that you just referred to, I'd be happy to follow up on it. That's contrary to the guidance I provided, and I'm happy to go to BP with that.
Because they wouldn't even allow us to show video, to take pictures of some of the animals who were being cleaned. Some of the birds, saying that you're not allowed to do that, which sounded very strange to me.
As I said, Wolf, if you pass on the particulars when we get off camera, I will follow up personally.
And you will order BP to go ahead, barring, except for security, except for some other major consideration, you'll tell them, and you're the incident commander, you're the man in charge, go ahead and open up these areas.
Again, Wolf, there are some considerations for safety and security. Other than that, there's no good reason why. But we cannot force an individual, to talk if they don't want to talk. But we can make the policy clear. And if there's a violation of the policy, I'm happy to deal with it.
One bottom line, you're going to be on this operation until it's over with. I know you've retired as the commandant of the Coast Guard. What's your timeline? What's your game plan?
Well, Wolf, I was relieved of duties as the commandant on the 25th of May, and Admiral Papp is currently the commandant. I am currently on active duty, but legally I'm required to retire on 1 July, and discussion on my exact status and how that might move forward are actually going on right now.
So you might stay longer than July 1st?
I'm a work in progress, Wolf.
It's up to the President of the United States. If he says, Admiral Allen, we need you longer, you'll salute and say, yes, sir.
We're having those discussions.
All right. Well, good luck, Admiral. Thanks for your service. Thanks for helping us better appreciate what's going on. We really need your help.
Thank you, Wolf.